Good morning. This is I'm him. So it's a pleasure to open this morning session, and especially having at the back this banner saying "Science for the Benefit of Humanity," which may sound familiar to some of you. This is not the only thing, as you may heard from Dr. Young, that we share in common. It's not just a common goal. There is a lot of the philosophy of the two institutions that we share in common. The bottom-up approach, the curiosity-driven research, the no undergraduate structure, and over the years we've developed endless ties with many individuals here, our students, many of our faculties spent time here and joined us later, so there couldn't be a more natural venue to hold this morning session than the Rockefeller University, and we really thank you for hosting us here this morning. Today's session is about partnership in innovation. And you know, the whole gathering is around the partnership between science and philanthropy. And allow me to say a few words about today's topic, which I think is, I'll dare to say, the best example of this partnership. I would go even further and say that I cannot think of any other area in which the partnership between philanthropy and science has made a bigger impact than the area of recruiting young scientists, and I want to explain. First of all, this definition of young scientists this term needs some explanation. What do you exactly mean by young scientists? A week ago, we had the graduation ceremony at the Weizmann Institute. 130 men and women at their early 30s stood on the podium, on the stage, wearing funny black gowns and even funnier hat on their heads. They've ended more or less 10 years, give or take a year or two. Some of them did it a little faster, some of them a little slower, of academic education. They got their PhDs in sciences at the Weizmann Institute. 10 years of long training, undergraduate and graduate studies. Similarly, ceremonies like that are being held at other institutions in Israel, and producing this talent, pool of talent, of many hundreds of PhDs in sciences. For most of them, this is the end of their academic training, and they will go by and large, and be the backbone of the Israeli high-tech industry and hold positions in various companies, research, private research institutions, etc. But for a good number of them, this is just a milestone, another one. They will go, after this long 10 years, for yet another training period, which would typically last another 3 to 5 years. This is the postdoctoral studies. Indeed, some of them will come to this place or to others. At this moment, just at the Boston area, around Harvard, MIT, and other universities there, there are about 100 Israeli postdocs that are conducting their postdoctoral studies after completing this 10 years, long 10 years of academic training. So here we go, We'll hear a little bit about clocks later on this session, but 15 years have already passed. And this, if you look at it, is one of the longest training. I don't think that there is any other profession that takes 15 years and just to be qualified to enter the next stage. Now, this long training resembles very much another long race. It reminds me always of the 10,000 meter race that we see in athletic competitions. You know, it's a long race. At the beginning, there are always some who would be ahead of the group. They usually get tired somewhere along the way. The leadership is changing at the course of time. But towards the final rounds, a pack of front runners is easily identified. These are the leaders of that group. And these are the people that, after going through this long 10,000 meters race, are the ones that are going to make it first. They are going to be the first to cross the end line. The problem, however, is that this race is being held in a large stadium. And there are many spectators to this race. Many of them are presidents, vice presidents, deans, scientists of other universities. And they also look at this race, and everybody is after those people who are at the head of the pack, the ones that lead the group. And here comes the challenge. The challenge is to make sure that these individuals that are so well trained, and they got, you know, the best education that you can imagine, will not come to your place and will be part of the team that you try to assemble for the next years, the ones that will conduct the research at the Weizmann Institute. And this is exactly the point where you get into the picture. It is a very competitive time. It's usually very short. Everybody is after them. And we need to be here and there at the right moment, at the right time, give them an offer, rely on this mutated gene that they have that convinced them that of all other places in the world, they will choose to come back to Israel, but nevertheless, give them the means, give them the possibility to conduct the research at the Weizmann Institute. And I'm telling you, it's a fantastic feeling to know that we can make them an offer, even though we don't have yet the resources, but we always know that when we come back to you, you will stand up for the challenge and help us in fulfilling our commitment and allow us to bring those scientists back. It can be by endowing their chairs, by helping covering their startup package, by buying the instrumentation that they need, scholarship for their students, whatever. It can be small or large gift. But we know that at the end of the day, you will come to our help and get those people abroad. And to give you a sense of the impact of it, I need to correct the number. Over the last 7.5 years that Chaim, Daniel, and I share this burden, this responsibility of ensuring the Institute future, we have managed to recruit about 80 young scientists. To give you an idea, this is the size of Rockefeller. This is about a third of the faculty at the Weizmann Institute. And the startup cost was about approximately about $100 million. And all of it was done, all of it, not part of it, not the majority, all of it was done thanks to your help. So I think for the first time in this global gathering, the ones who deserve a round of applause is you and not us. And I welcome you to applaud yourself for this amazing support. So I think I've more or less explained to you what it involves. Today's session, there will be two presenters, two young scientists that have arrived to the Institute, just recently, the other one a couple of years ago, and they have another thing in common. Both of them, as part of their training, have fulfilled the dream of any Jewish mother. They've also completed, during their training, an MD. They got their MD, they became a medical doctor, and despite that, they've decided that this virus of research did not leave them, and they decided to go into research. The first speaker would be Dr. Eran Elinav. Eran received his MD from the Hebrew University in Jerusalem in 1999. He did a residency in internal medicine at Hadassah University Hospital for 4 years. And then he actually decided to join a very interesting program that we have launched at the Weizmann Institute, which is the PhD for MD. He did his PhD in immunology with a person that we heard a little bit about yesterday, with Zeli Geshchar, and got his PhD at the Weizmann Institute in 2009. Then he spent a few years of postdoctoral research at Yale University School of Medicine, and he joined the faculty at the Weizmann Institute in 2012, almost 2 years ago. Eran's research focuses on the interaction of our body with its environment, and I think I will allow him to get into the details. I'll just give you his title, which is quite interesting. He's going to talk about a gut feeling, the surprising role of our intestinal microbes in health and disease. Please,